Okay, my name's Gavin. I do theoretical physics as a day job, and I've been roped into doing today's linear algebra. My areas of expertise include section 18.7.1. So you want to know anything about 18.7.1? So we're going to review linear algebra. Why should we care? Linear algebra is an extremely powerful and elegant piece of mathematics that is also extremely useful. It just crops up all over the place. So quantum mechanics is all linear algebra. If you ever want to learn quantum mechanics, learn linear algebra first, then you'll be confused by the deep conceptual problems rather than the superficial mathematical problems. Markov chain Monte Carlo, which is probably in the book somewhere, any kind of stochastic processes, and a lot of machine learning. And it tends to just crop up all over the place. And so there's a core of it that's not that big and very elegant and not that hard as mathematics goes. The kind of problem with linear algebra is there's a lot of it. So one can get a bit overwhelmed. There's a lot of different definitions and terms and ideas. But this chapter that's in the book is really focusing just on a few core ideas and then a few applications of linear algebra that actually turn up later in the book. So linear algebra already has three things in it. Scalars, which, what are we using here? A. Scalars, something like 3. Scalars are numbers. That's all they are, they're just numbers. It's just that in this particular context of linear algebra, we happen to call them scalars. And the reason is that mathematics is a language, and the objective of any language is to communicate, to be understood. And for historical reasons, we tend to call numbers scalars in this context. And if you call them numbers, people get confused. There's some obscure mathematical situations where the scalars aren't regular numbers, but they don't matter in practice. Whenever you see scalar, it's just a number. And then we have vectors. So vector, something like x. Vector. We might write it as a column numbers. So I've written sort of a basic vector, some sort of list of numbers. A list of numbers is not a vector per se. A vector, it becomes a vector by virtue of what we do with the vector. So a list of numbers is a sort of representation of this mathematical object, which is the vector. What matters about vectors? What matters about vectors is really, there's just a few properties. One is that you can add them. So I've got two vectors, and I can add them together and form a third vector. Now, you can see from this representation as a list of numbers, that's only going to work if the two lists are the same size. But if they are the same length, you can add them. And the other property is that I'm allowed to multiply them by scalars. So I can multiply a vector by a number and get back a vector. And it's linear, in the sense that I can multiply first before I add, or I can add and then multiply, and you get the same answer. And that's really all there is mathematically to a vector. People tend to use some fancy notation. Anytime you see this little twiddly R or any other letter that has sort of this outline font on it, it represents some mathematical gadget. And in this case, the R represents real numbers. So just the numbers that floating point numbers are trying to represent, are trying to approximate. And so R to the N just means a vector, a list of N real numbers. And that, for our purposes, is typically what our vectors are made out of. Could be integers, could be complex numbers or something fancier, but typically there's just gonna be a list of N numbers. Now, I wrote this as a column. You can also get vectors that are rows. Y, 1, 2, 4. And then there's an operation called a transpose that converts one to the other. Transpose, 1, 2, 4. And so sometimes we call, to make this distinct, and this is sort of our default, sometimes we call these column vectors, and these ones row vectors, just to make that distinction clear. And this transpose, the big T, just means that you sort of flip everything onto its side. It looks kind of trivial, but But actually, there's like these deep mathematical properties behind the fact that you have this these two types of vectors that relate in this similar way. And the other thing is matrices. So first of all, we have single numbers, then we have some list of numbers, and a matrix, we typically use an uppercase letter, is just some square grid of numbers. Again, a spreadsheet full of numbers, an array of numbers, is not a matrix. What makes it a matrix is the way that we use the numbers, the way that we apply them to vectors. And then we have some other standard notation. Sort of, we want to tell you how big the matrix is, n by n. So that's rows by column, the number of rows and the number of columns. So I've written here a square matrix, an important special case of matrices, which has to be 3x3. But we also get rectangular arrays of numbers too. And tensors. So tensors are sort of these, in linear algebra, fancier versions of matrices. So if you think of a vector as being sort of one-dimensional and a matrix being two-dimensional, a tensor is three-dimensional, four-dimensional, however many dimensions you want. So again, it's become a bit of an abusive notation. People started, we used to just talk about multidimensional arrays of numbers, right, in our computers. And a tensor, again, is more than just an array of numbers. We can represent it by an array of numbers, but a tensor is defined by the mathematical operations that we do on it. But I guess, you know, multidimensional array flow would not be as sexy sounding. So abusive notation is a tensor. But again, tensors are really these mathematical objects that generalize the idea of matrices to a large number of dimensions. Although, we should come back to that. There's a confusion of notation here. So we can think of a vector as something that's living in, say, the actual space we're living in. Sometimes we talk about vectors as if they're arrows pointing out in space. And we call this a three-dimensional vector. Whereas when we're talking about how many sort of stacks of stuff here, we sometimes talk about it being a rank. So this is rank 0, rank 1, rank 2, and it tends to be higher order ranks. There's just a confusion of terminology one's got to look out for.
Sorry, what was that point you just made?
There's two different ways we can use the word dimension, and it gets confusing if you don't watch out for it. So here I just described, you know, you can think of these as being zero-dimensional or one-dimensional list, or two-dimensional array, but then we also call this a three-dimensional vector sometimes because it's got three items this way. And to make that distinction, we then talk about this being rank 0, rank 1, rank 2, rank 3, but then that also gets confusing because rank also gets used in a different way in a different context. So, like I said, the problem with linear algebra is there's a lot of it, and there's a lot of little bits of terminology and definitions that one's got to try to keep in mind, yes.
So a tensor is a stack of matrices.
Yeah, well, a three-dimensional tensor would be a stack of matrices, but it could be a, you know, four-dimensional cube of numbers as a representation. And, it sort of keeps on going. It's an arbitrary number of dimensions beyond that. But yeah, in the simplest case, think about a stack of matrices. Okay, transpose. Again, we talked about transpose for vectors. We can transpose a vector. For a matrix, we go straight down the diagonal if it's square. And flip all the numbers across this diagonal. So this would be equal to, the diagonal stays the same, 1, 5, 1, and then I flip the 4, 7, and 3 on top, and the 3, 2, and 8 come down here, and then I write a big T, kind of a stylized T to indicate transpose. So a matrix transpose, just this sort of flip to the two axes. Okay, so the most important operation that we could do with matrices and vectors is to multiply them together. And there's this complicated looking rule for doing this. Yes?
Sorry.
To
clarify, if maybe you can speak about broadcasting very quickly, like what broadcasting is and why broadcasting as opposed to part of the previous thing.
To broadcast?
Yeah, broadcasting in terms of if you want to add a vector to a matrix, what's happening to vector is called broadcasting.
It is, but that's not really a part of linear algebra per se. So you're thinking like something like NumPy, where it has all these fancy ways of adding a vector and a matrix, and like you said, good forecasting. And that's not really a part of linear algebra per se. That's really more like the way the numerical algorithm works. So it's a way of, yes, as you said, when there aren't enough axes and I want to add this to this, then NumPy will say, well, you should just add an extra couple of axes and sort of add these on. Personally, I find it black magic that works, but every time I come across it, I have to sort of sit down and really think it through. So I'm not going to try to explain it right now. I'll mess it up. But yes. So I kind of said that, you know, a lot of the sort of core part of linear algebra is not that complicated. But where things do get hard is actually in the numerical implementation of linear algebra. That's a dark art. You and I should never, ever, ever try to implement any kind of linear algebra and non-trivial linear algebra on a computer. We should use the library, because people spend many, many years optimizing those things, both for speed and to actually make them work properly. Okay, multiplying matrices and matrices and vectors. So I said before that sort of, where's the linear part come in? Before we think about a matrix versus a matrix, it's worth thinking about a matrix versus a vector. And this is why it's linear algebra. Suppose I have some matrix, and I can multiply it by that some vector, and I get out some other vector. Let's call it z. The trick is that I can multiply a matrix by some sum of vectors. It's the same as if I multiplied the matrix by each vector separately. It's linear in this sense. This is what the linear part means, actually, at a fundamental level. And that's sort of the key relation that's really behind linear algebra. Yes?
When you multiply a matrix by a vector, are you going through and for every cell, you know, doing that multiplication? Is how is that done?
Well, yeah, so we'll go through that. Because this is sort of the high-level mathematical property we want, but then when we actually do it for a matrix versus a vector, or a matrix versus a matrix, the actual rule looks a bit more complicated. So let's just, right now, let's have, say, some matrix, 1, 4, 2, and 0. I'm going to do 2 by 2, because so I don't have to do too much math. And I'm going to multiply it by some vector. And then the rule is that I go through each of the rows this way and multiply them down the columns that way. So what I get is, for the first row and the first column, is 1 times 1 plus 2 times 2. Now there's only one column here, so then I move on to the second row, and it's 4 times 1 plus 0 times 2. So I get, what was that? 1, 5, and 5. So it's this procedure where you go this row, that column, this row, and that column. If I expand this out to a matrix, then I would get a 2 by 2 matrix out the other side. So the rule is, this is n by n. The next thing you're multiplying has to be n by some other number, p. And the output matrix is going to be m by p. So the things in the middle, so to speak, have to smoosh together and match. And they get eliminated, and you're left with the two sides on the outside. So here you go this way and that way, and then this way and that way for the second column. and this way, and that way, and this way, and that way. And that's what this is trying to illustrate. Here we've got 2 by 2, and then 2 by 4, and it's showing that one element right in the middle is these two times by those two added together.
Wait, so you always end up with their lowest common denominator? If I have like a vector with 2 entries and a matrix with 4, then I'm going to end up with 2 entries for the vector.
Well, it'd be have to be like 4 by 2 and then by 2. And then you're going to get out a 4 by 2 for that one. So I always think about it is that when you write it out like this, it's these dimensions on the outside that want to come together. And like I said, these rules look really kind of, when you first come across them, they look kind of, what am I doing here? I encourage you to do this by hand in a few examples, and you will get fed up by the time you try to do 3 by 3 matrices or something. Do it a few times and see how it works, and then just to accept that this is the right mathematical procedure that gives us all these nice properties. Like I said, there's lots of definitions that go with linear algebra, and there's lots of special matrices that come up in applications, and one that comes up all the time is the identity matrix. And so that's any square matrix that just has ones down the diagonal and zeros everywhere else. And if we want to keep track of how big it is, we put a little subscript on the bottom. So traditionally it's a big I for identity, and a little subscript, which is optional, if you need to keep track of how big this identity is. The trick is, any vector multiplied by this identity, any matrix multiplied by this identity, gives you back the original matrix. It's acting like the number 1 in math. When you multiply any number by 1, you get that number back. When you multiply any matrix by the identity, you get that original matrix back.
Sorry for your last question for a while. Can you see how big it is, like I3? What does it mean? That's like the third value in the matrix? Or
no, because this particular matrix is 3 by 3. There's 9 entries altogether.
Okay.
So if it was 4 by 4, we'd write a little 4. Okay. So it could be an arbitrary number. It's always square for the identity. But it could be of arbitrary size. And so if we've got an expression where we need to keep track of the size of the matrices, we'll put little subscripts on like this to keep track of the sizes. A lot of the time, we're writing more abstractly. It doesn't matter. We know it's some size that's compatible with whatever things we're multiplying it by. So you understand the size by context. So an expression such as a matrix times by a vector, which gives you another vector, is really this set of linear equations. Each row gives you a different sort of equation that has to equal a different scalar within the vector. There's a notation here that's used in this slide, which is the colon. It's just meant to mean, I'm specifying here a row, the colon's meant to be all the entries in that column. It's like Python, when you just use the single column, single colon. So the kind of situation you sometimes end up in pretty frequently is that I know Y and I know the matrix A, but I'd like to know what X is. And depending on the matrix and the Y, depending on the matrix, there might be no solution to that. There might be many solutions, but typically there's one solution. If there's one solution, it means that matrix is invertible. I think that's the next slide. So let's talk about matrix inversion. So inversion, again, is much like taking a reciprocal for a number. The inverse of 2 is a half. A half times 2 is 1. So it's the same idea for a matrix. A matrix inverse is the matrix that I multiply by to get back the identity. Instead of 1, it's the identity. Not all matrices have inverses. For one thing, you've got to be square. And then there's a whole bunch of other properties that need to be satisfied. However, a lot of the time, a lot of the matrices we care about do have inverses. If the matrix has an inverse, then this problem has got an easy solution. I just multiply both sides by inverse, and I get out that x is equal to a inverse y. Now, it's worth pointing out that that's fine for sort of abstract mathematical analysis. The problem is, there are a couple of problems. One of which is that actually taking a matrix inverse is a very expensive operation. So if your matrix is big, you don't want to take the inverse. Your computer will die. And a lot of the time what we see in applications is that people work out sort of math using whatever linear algebra they need to figure out the properties of what's going on. And then they'll spend a lot of time figuring out how to do that efficiently, avoiding ever actually doing an inverse. So again, a lot of the time doing the math, you just take an inverse, if you can show that it exists, it's great. But in practical applications, you generally don't want to take inverses. They're slow. And they're unstable, I think it says that here. Meaning that small changes in the numbers in the matrix can sometimes lead to dramatically different results for the inverse. Some properties for when it's invertible, whatever. It has to be square. And there's some other sort of properties which I think are on the later slide, which we'll come back to. Norms. Often we want to know how long, in some sense, a vector is. But there's more than one reasonable way of defining how long a vector is. These are some sort of abstract mathematical properties of what you would like it to mean for some measure to have a length. And so these are called norms. These are sort of just a few of the ones that come up most often in practice. Again, this comes back to the idea there's an awful lot of linear algebra. This is, we're quickly summarizing some of the bits you're going to see later on in the book. The L2 norm, that's really just your intuitive sense of how you measure distances in the real world in the Euclidean plane. So if I want to go this way and then that way, well, going across the triangle like that, that's our distance, that's what the L2 distance is trying to get, yes.
So how can a vector, though, because these are single points, right? They're just one dimensional, right?
No, yes, but they're one dimensional list of numbers. But if I'm thinking about, So one way you can think about it, if I'm thinking about just a plane, that would be a two-dimensional vector, you can actually sort of think about it representing a direction, a distance on that plane. So this would be the vector, this direction. And you see in a lot of textbooks, they try to get your intuition about vectors by talking to them about as if imagine they're arrows pointing out into space somewhere. The problem with that intuition is you can start thinking the vectors are arrows pointing out into space, where they're really these more mathematically abstract things. So they can be used to represent distances in the real world, and so that's useful because now we're talking about distances, so it's kind of useful to have that intuition in these particular cases. So the L1 norm, I like to think of as the Manhattan distance, or the taxicab distance. If you're in Manhattan and you want to get from here to here, I can't take the diagonal because I'm on a grid, so I have to do something like that. Or, which is the same as just going north, east and then north, taxicab distance. Again, these are sort of things that will come up in applications at some point. Again, there's a bazillion special matrices, and a lot of different names for these things. Symmetric matrix means if I take transpose, hey, I get back the same thing. A real symmetric matrix, jump ahead. Is diagonalizable. We'll get to that in the next slide or two. And orthogonal matrices, basically the transpose is their own inverse. Very nice class of matrices that again crop up all over the time. Orthogonal matrices, coming back to this idea of vectors being sort of points pointing out into space, orthogonal matrices represent rotations of vectors in that sense. If you can have that intuitive picture. Okay, so this is sort of the key, central, beautiful result of linear algebra. It makes so much linear algebra both possible and useful. And it's the idea that we can decompose matrices into components. not all matrices, but many matrices, and a lot of times matrices we care about. And these components we call eigenvectors and eigenvalues. And eigen is a German word that means something, doesn't really matter. It's just something that's become associated with these particular, because they needed some notations, so they came up with, we started using eigenvalue, eigenvector. So the idea is that if I have a matrix, and I multiply it by a vector, sometimes for some vectors, I get back that vector, multiplied by a number, a scalar. So if I multiply a matrix by a vector and I get back the same vector, except maybe the with a constant out front, that's called an eigenvector. It's one of the things that don't change in some sense when I multiply them by the matrix. And the constant out front, these are called the eigenvalues. And these, the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, really encapsulate the entire behavior of the matrix. So if the matrix has a bunch of eigenvectors and eigenvalues, doesn't always, but if it does, we can write the matrix in a diagonal form. There's big V, diag, lambda, more notation, big V, minus 1, sorry. So this is a diagonal matrix which has the eigenvalues down the diagonal. So I'll just number them. Everything else is 0. These Vs, these are matrices that are made out of the eigenvectors. And what can you say about this? The fact that this works just makes a lot of things really easy. For one thing, we were talking about invertibility. If I would like to invert this matrix, I would like to invert a matrix. Well, if I've got the eigen decomposition, it's easy. I actually leave the eigenvectors alone, and I just looked at these eigenvalues and I invert those. So as long as I've got a bunch of eigenvalues that aren't zero, I can invert the matrix. So you have matrices that are diagonalizable, which is a fancy way of saying that this decomposition exists, but that aren't invertible because one of these eigenvalues is zero. Now again, just as trying to find the inverse is an expensive operation, trying to find all of the eigenvectors and eigenvalues is an expensive operation. But what happens a lot of the time in practice is you only care about the largest few eigenvalues. And there are procedures just to extract out the largest eigenvalue and its corresponding eigenvector when you need them. So often what happens is if you can decompose this matrix into this kind of spectrum of eigenvalues, you often find there's some big ones and a bunch of small ones. You can basically throw the small ones away, just set them to zero, and you will not really change the matrix very much. And that kind of approximation turns out to be really useful a lot of the time. This is just trying to get your intuition about what's going on with eigenvectors and eigenvalues. This is meant to represent, the two arrows on the left are meant to represent the eigenvectors. So you can think about the matrix being composed out of these two eigenvectors, but then different matrices with the same eigenvectors have different eigenvalues, which just means the eigenvectors are sort of different lengths for the different matrices. Yes?
So if the eigenvalues are the same in vectors that don't look like they're the same shape, they're actually related, or the same, even though they don't look the same.
Sorry, say that again? There's a sense in which, yeah, if you've got the same set of eigenvectors, if two matrices have the same set of eigenvectors, they turn out to be compatible with each other in a certain sense. They're almost like you can take those two matrices and, in a sense, rotate them into each other. They're looking at the same same family of matrices that I'm interested in. There's sort of a family of matrices which all have the same eigenvectors, but have different eigenvalues. And that family are all intimately related to each other, kind of like taking a rotation in this big matrix space. Yes. So, one problem is if your eigenvalues are the same. So, in an identity matrix, every eigen is already diagonal, so all its eigenvalues must be one. But when your eigenvalues are one, when your eigenvalues are the same, you don't get this unique decomposition. So, when we talk about this nice decomposition here, I'm really implicitly assuming that all these numbers are different from each other. If they're not, if some of these numbers are the same, life gets more complicated. And I'm sort of brushing over that because I don't want to get bogged down in it. There are other things you can do to handle that situation, but some of the nice properties go away. But yeah, basically everything is an eigenvector of the identity matrix. So we're sort of getting into things that are not exactly in the core of linear algebra, but that actually singular value decomposition turns up a lot in machine learning applications. So singular value decomposition, I just said that this decomposition does not work all the time, particularly it has to be a square matrix. Singular value decomposition is a way of getting around that. It's kind of like the same decomposition, but not. It works all of the time, it works all of the time. You can always write down a singular value decomposition, but it doesn't quite have as many nice properties as the eigenvalue decomposition. Pseudo inverse. So we talked about inverses. Inverse is kind of like having a one, isn't it? Inverse is like taking the reciprocal of numbers. So a pseudo inverse is something, well, again, I can't take an inverse of a lot of matrices. Particularly, one of these eigenvalues is zero, I can't take the inverse. A pseudo inverse is a way of getting around that problem. Same way the singular value decomposition is a way of getting around a problem that you can't always diagonalize the matrix. A pseudo inverse is something that's not really an inverse. If the matrix is invertible, it's the same thing as the inverse. But if it's not invertible, it sort of generalizes that idea, keeps some of the nice mathematical properties. And the most common example that we run into is this Moore Penrose pseudo inverse. It's not the only one, but it's the most common one. So people just say pseudo inverse with a qualification, they generally mean this one. Now this is the same Penrose as Penrose Tiles, and she wrote some book on, what was it called, Emperor's New Clothes or something. Same guy. This comes back to this problem. Oh, I raised it. If I wanted to find the solutions to a simple linear equation, AX equals Y is invertible, I just invert the matrix and find the solution. If it's not invertible, turns out what I can do is this pseudo inverse. In a sense, it gives me the closest approximate answer in a particular sense to that particular problem, which is why this particular pseudo inverse crops up. So again, it's getting around the problem that a lot of the time, this is nice, but this kind of equation is nice, but in practice, it doesn't always work. And often when things don't work, there's a way around that which maybe loses some of the nice mathematical properties, but is more general. It's always this trade-off. We won't go through this. It's basically singular value decomposition is that allows you to calculate the pseudo inverse, just as the eigenvalue decomposition is one way of calculating the regular inverse. And trace. Again, there's like a bazillion different definitions and things. The trace is just the sum of the diagonal elements of the matrix. Looks kind of useless. Why do I want to do that? Because it's also the sum of the eigenvalues. So if I had a diagonal matrix and eigenvalues are just numbers straight down the down the middle. So the nice thing is the trace is always the sum of the eigenvalues, and that therefore is very easy to calculate for any matrix. I don't have to find out all the eigenvalues. And the determinant, somebody was asking about that earlier, determinant is the product of the eigenvalues. So there's this definition, there's this whole procedure for getting the determinant for matrices that they sort of introduce in linear algebra books. It's a total pain in the ass. And it doesn't give any intuition about what the determinant is. The determinant is the product of the eigenvalues. That's the number you're trying to get out with the determinant. And I can, sort of summary slide. It's very useful to do some practice problems, work through that, doing matrix multiplication by hand a few times until you get bored of that. But try not to get overwhelmed by the breadth of the subject. There is just an awful lot of it, and it's really useful, but there's lots of nooks and crannies. Most of it's fairly straightforward, some of it's really difficult. Most of the stuff you encounter in practice, it's not that hard, as math goes. But it's more about trying to keep all these different definitions and procedures and things you can do with the matrices straight. So we're open up to discussion. Questions? Yes.
Can you give some examples on how eigen compositions or what eigenvalues are?
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, sorry. So you wanted an example of eigen decomposition. Now, the ones that immediately jump to mind because I come from physics background. So in quantum mechanics, we often care about the energy of a system. That's encoded in this matrix called the Hamiltonian. And it turns out the eigenvalues of that matrix are the individual energy levels that the system can have. When you're talking about stochastic processes, you'll often have this matrix that represents probability, jumping between different states probabilistically. And again, the eigenvalues of that matrix actually have some constraining properties that tell you about things like how quickly do I sort of explore my space that I'm trying to sort of diffuse around it. Then another wide application, again, is this idea of trying to approximate some big-ass matrix. It's got a lot of eigenvalues that are very close to zero. Those are not really important. That's principal component analysis. And so essentially what you're doing, although you try to get around actually having to do the eigen decomposition, because that's a pain, but in principle what you're doing is you're finding the low eigenvalues and throwing those away. So the answer is it crops up all the time.
Yeah? You mentioned stochastic processes in PageRank, basically, from Google is the kind of reason math teachers describe eigen values, because they you find for each node in the graph the probability that your random path will get at that point in the graph, and if you solve that equation, it stabilizes in the eigenvalues.
No, but you're right. So as you were saying, PageRank algorithm is sort of originally set up as this random walk across web pages, and right, it's basically eigen decomposition analysis to get out the PageRank pages. It's the stationary distribution you're trying to get out, which is the eigenvector associated with the largest eigenvalue. In that case, the eigenvalue is 1. The largest eigenvalue is 1. It's this thing with math, right? For my own part, I tend to like to learn my mathematics as mathematics and trust that it's going to use it down the road. And eigen decomposition, absolutely. It just crops up. Once you've got that, you can see it crop up all the time. And a lot of things that otherwise look complicated end up looking really straightforward.
Is there an easy way to show us how that math magic works on the board?
Which belt?
About the eigenvector coming
on the other side,
showing that one matrix
ability.
I don't know.
No, well, I could if I thought about it, but not off the top of my head. So the question is, this idea that matrices are the same eigen vectors with different eigenvalues are sort of interrelated in this interesting way. And I would have to sort of go into some bunch of math that we haven't explained yet.
Question?
Oh, yes, please.
I animation systems for movies, whether you can. But other than that, I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's the kind of thing. You're asking about similar array decomposition. And again, it crops up a lot in those kind of situations where you've got a big array, but now it's not square, right? So I can't take an eigenvalue. I can't take an eigenvalue decomposition. So it's the same kind of idea of, I want to form the singular values are kind of like the eigenvalues, and typically what you're looking for is the largest ones, the most important ones, and the small ones are unimportant. So it's the same kind of idea. You take the singular value decomposition. Now you've got a diagonal matrix in the middle, which is the singular values rather than the eigenvalues. Throw away the small ones, and you sort of that means you also throw away the eigenvectors, and you get back a matrix that approximates the original matrix, and has thrown away a bunch of irrelevant stuff. Again, this is very common in machine learning, sort of classical machine learning algorithms, right? I think rather than sort of new fancy deep learning stuff. Yes.
Is that something where you throw away the small eigenvalues? That's not useful in like pure mathematics, but it's useful in computing it? Or is there a use for it also in actual math?
I'm sure there is a use in pure mathematics, but no, I think that's more like an application as a way of applying this stuff. Yeah, I'd say that's more on the application side. I'm sure there is a use in just pure mathematics somewhere. But that's one that really just comes up when we're trying to apply these ideas in a practical way. And again, it's this idea that sort of the platonic mathematical ideals here, and then how we actually deal with them in the real world. And that's one of those ones that comes up more when we're trying to deal with these things in the real world and try to make everything work in a reasonable time frame. A lot of these mathematical gadgets are fine as mathematics, you can't apply in a practical sense if we actually had a big ass matrix. Yes.
This is kind of a big ask, but could we go over the derivation of principal components analysis?
No. Because I didn't review it, and I will probably mess it up. But we could, you know, we're going to break up and maybe do some, what do you call it? some exercises. And I'm happy to sit down and try to work our way through it.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
awesome. That'd be great. And are you able to talk kind of more conceptually about it to gain some intuition?
A principal component analysis? Sure, we can do that. Okay. But I'll have to like stare at the page so you can review that. Like I said, linear algebra has just the huge breadth to it, you know? And I don't keep it all in my head at the same time. And every time I work on a new problem that involves linear algebra, I learn something new. So it's just this big subject. Yes?
How old is linear algebra?
Oh.
Do we need to go back to our...
Oh no, it's probably like 100 years old, something like that. Must be a bit longer than that, mid-1800s, I guess. It's not like ancient mathematics. By mathematical standards. Huh?
Like calculus.
It's more recent than calculus. Yeah. It's easier than calculus, but it's more recent than calculus.
More questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Could you talk about how eigenvalue decomposition and SVD pop up in neural nets and deep learning?
Those kind of things may be a good question for our guest speaker who's coming soon, because he actually deals a lot with like applying math to neural nets.
I think that's getting beyond my core expertise there. My impression is that particularly for the deep networks, it's more about trying to understand how these networks work and finding ways of sort of analyzing what's going on. Because the deep networks have part of the points that are non-linear. You have these linear parts, which are just linear algebra, but then we also apply these non-linearities at the end of each level. The reason that's important is because if it was all linear, if each level was linear, the whole thing is linear, because it's then just a multiplication of a whole bunch of matrices. creatures. And this goes way back to the early history of neural nets. Very early, I think the very first AI winter was when somebody pointed out that having a bunch of neurons, deep neurons, is useless because it doesn't matter how many levels you are, they're all linear, the whole thing's just linear, so might as well have that. And then at some point, they start bringing in inheritance, fixed solid neuron. Yes?
One thing you're great for is like something you have, say, like different filters, which there's some redundancy in terms of how they receive a given thing. You can, like, if you take a covariance matrix of like how they interrelate with each other, the eigenvalues of that. Like, I don't, you know, you're saying eigen. I think in German it means something along the lines of principle. So, like, reorients your variable space on the axes of principal variance. So, it kind of summarizes your features and makes the data more palatable, except especially for analysis from something outside the network.
Yeah. Although, I think eigen does not mean principle. It means something totally prosaic, like own or something.
Self.
There we go. But principle is sort of what the English word that people used to use before eigenvalue and eigenvector sort of took over.
Every time I hear principle component analysis, yeah. I think it's a silly term and they should just call it eigendecomposition, but maybe that's because I learned one before the other.
Right, and it goes with the, you know, it's a big field and lots of different terminology and some of it's in conflict with each other. But yeah. Any more framework?
Yep, there's a question.
Another comment on the use of SVD. To go from one layer to of the network to the next layer, sometimes you do this tensor multiplication, and it's pretty slow. So some people were trying to do SVD so that they simplify this tensor to the like minimal information so they can move fast between layers. So optimization technique.
And that
I think he was mentioning the SVD might be used as feature extraction in general.
Right.
I don't know for deep learning. I guess you can use it.
Oh, well, we're on the topic. I think that one other reason to use SVD or PCA for deep learning purposes is because when the data is really highly correlated together and you try to learn structures from that, that kind of is problematic because the data is too correlated. So you use PCA to decorrelate the axes from each other and try to learn reason. That's usually used as a pre-processing step.
When you're talking about norms, are you talking about L1 and L2, or is that the same thing as the L2 regularization, L1 regularization?
Yeah, that's where that term's coming from. When they say L2, is because they're putting a function on that looks like that. Basically, they're measuring the length of the vector in this particular way and constraining how long the vector is. And the vector is now your set of weights in the layer at that point.
So in that use, the L2 is just using the function to kind of measure the matrix and then keep it in line? Or?
It's a way, yeah. You've got this big matrix of weights, basically. And it's trying to find a way of keeping those weights within some constraint, not trying to prevent it becoming too big. So you need a measure of how big they are. And so those are the sort of two sort of standard options, one L1 and L2. And L2 is kind of like it's basically a squared thing. So it's like having a spring, basically. Right? It's just like, you know, I'm putting a spring and I'm sort of, the strength of the spring is sort of constraining. So the spring will let it move around a little bit, but we'll prevent it from going too far away.
So it's
getting this nice little harmonic probability distribution.
Okay. It amplifies, okay, is what you're saying, right?
Amplifies. It's trying to, no, I don't want to think about it as bouncing up and down. That's the wrong analogy. I'm just trying to say there's a little well that's trying to keep the weights inside of and not let it.
It's not used for absolute value purposes because they're already positive.
Oh no, these are the weights, right? So these are the weights that can be positive. Right?
So I think this would be a good time if you could. guys don't have any questions, to like split into like work groups.